Thank you, Professor Atre. So I've been given 2 hours, and talking in front of you for 2 hours at a stretch is a bit of a problem. Not for me, but for you people, rather. So let's try and do it in a friendly and as comfortable, whatever, like as possible. And then we'll have interactive kind of discussions, and whenever you have doubts and all, you can ask me, you can stop me in between. Okay, I have some more than 100 slides. Okay, not necessary that I should cover all of them. Okay, ultimate aim is to have some fruitful discussion coming out of this, right? And as Professor Atre said, this is an entity which started about 5 years back with a very different purpose, strongly linked with the theme of your TechWeb course: innovation, entrepreneurship, and incubation. But of course, in social space. And why social space and all? We'll see as and when we go ahead, and how it is different from a normal innovation entrepreneurship that we talk about. I'm going to take some time on that. Okay, initially we'll just spend some time before I tell you about the center. But of course, the first introductory slide is, as I said, it started in 2014, and as the name says, it is through the funds coming from Tata Trusts. Okay, and Tata company has nothing to do with this, because most of the time people think that is a Tata center means started by Tata Group or something. Tata Trust is different. It's just a donation that has come to IIT Bombay, and it is an entity which is in IIT Bombay. It is part of IIT Bombay, like any other center of IIT Bombay. Okay, right. So the main purpose here is, in very simple terms, a few words, I would say, it is to try and do some technological or design interventions for society. Okay. Now, when I say technological or design interventions, means what? Like, it is not social work. It is not social service. That's how it's different from social work. Okay. So it is basically you should come up with some innovations that would serve the society. Now, in society, if you see, there are, of course, like you see, the rich people, the poor people, right? So there are resource rich people, there are resource constrained people, right? So the center looks at resource constrained, not just people, it can be in industry as well. Now, in the industry also, you have a hierarchy, right? Like you have rich industry, you have small industry, cottage industry, right? And those who are at the bottom, they always are constrained in terms of resources, right? For some reasons or the other, right? Now, idea is, can we do something for them? Okay. Is there a possibility of doing it? Now, you can imagine this is a very different concept, right? Like most of the times, innovations are done for something that is driven by the market, right? Driven by the market. So I'm introducing a term called market driven. Now, how market would drive something? There's a demand, right? In market. Why there's a demand? There's a need. Just need would drive the market? No. People should be able to pay for their need, right? That means there should be a buying power, right? So that means those who are resource rich would drive the market. That's how things go on, right? I hope you understand, rather you are with me, okay? If you don't agree with me, just raise your hand, we'll have a discussion. But I'm just trying to kind of convey the philosophy of Tata Center here, right? So coming back to what I was saying, that market driven means the people who are resource rich would drive the market, and those who are not probably will be out of the game, right? they are linked, okay? They are indirectly getting benefits of what's happening, right? But things are not done for them. Things are not done for them as customers, right? Or stakeholders. They may influence the system to some extent, right? But if I'm looking at innovations, most of the times I look at market, I look at customer, I look at need of that customer who's going to pay me, right? So now the concept here is that look for something which is not market driven, right? Not market driven. It's more challenging, right? It's more challenging. So something which is market driven itself, doing intervention, incubation, entrepreneurship, it's all difficult, right? Whereas something is not market driven and still try and do interventions, like, it is a bit difficult or more difficult, right? I hope it is clear. So imagine a farmer, imagine a waste picker, imagine somebody who is facing problems, not health problems rather, and not able to pay hospital charges, fees, right? Can we do something for this sector? What is that sector? Resource constraint and not doesn't have access to the fruits of high-end technology, right? So imagine, like, whatever technological developments are happening, most of the times the target customer is somebody sitting at the top of that pyramid. Now, what is that pyramid? You know all that, right? Bottom up pyramid and all that. So bottom means you have large number of people or industries at the bottom who are looking for resources, okay, and struggling to get the benefits of what's happening at the top, right? So with this challenge, so Trust came to IIT, said that fine, we give you resources, we give you funds, try and come up with something, okay, that can probably address the issues of this sector. Now, this something is very broad, okay, and that's the beauty, right? Like, the Trust gives money, like, they say that now it's up to you to decide. We are not giving, we ourselves don't know, okay, what's good for them, right? And why IIT? Now, are we going to solve all the problems that are faced by the society of this country? There are hundreds of millions of problems that we are facing in every sector. Now, what is that IIT can do? Start is one thing, yes. But in terms of impact, I don't know where that line exists here. Yeah, the second one. To create human resources, that's the purpose, that's the mandate of any academic institute, okay, right? So in IIT, normally we teach engineering, right? But at the same time, we inculcate this philosophy among students, okay, and try and get some people to think on these lines, okay? We are teaching them technology anyway, okay? We're not diverting it from that, but see whether the technology can be applied, can be used for this purpose, all right? So, idea is to create human resources. That's the main purpose, of course. We should not go away from that. So, focus on people and communities with limited resources. And of course, we can start with India. There are 100 problems around us, okay? We don't have to go out of India, that, right? And of course, whatever solutions we develop here may be applicable to other developing countries. Now, if you want to do this, how is it different, the business as usual in IIT? Like, of course, you know, all of you are from academic institutes, right? So, IIT is similar. Only difference is probably that we are supposed to do research also, and there's some funding that comes from central government, and when we are evaluated for our performance, it's not just teaching, but research is also seen. And of course, impact, right? So, in IIT, normally a professor means he has to publish, right? He has to get some articles published in peer-reviewed high-impact factor journals and so on, right? So we have to do research in laboratory. Like every professor in IIT would have a laboratory, have PhD students working with him or her, right? How is this different then? We are supposed to do that anyway. I'm professor of chemical engineering. I'm supposed to do that. I have some projects going on in chemical engineering, sponsored by DST, DBT, whatever, MHRD. I should see to it that I do this also simultaneously. At the same time, not just restrict myself to laboratory, but see whether it goes out of laboratory. That's very important. That's the mandate given to us to Tata Center, that don't restrict yourself to laboratory. Unlike what's happening otherwise in IIT. I'm not saying that's bad, okay? It's different, okay? That's different. What does it mean? There are two types of research activities, fundamental research and applied research, right? When you do fundamental research, most of the times your outcome is judged by what you publish in international journals, right? But when you do applied research, you can always publish, but at the same time, it is expected that somebody sees the fruit of it some point of time, which is of immediate interest. When you say it is basic research, it is useful, but not necessarily in next 10 years, can be next 50 years, 100 years or whatever, right? And nobody would ask you, like, unless it is a knowledge creation, right? Okay. Right. So, here the idea Tata Center is for applied research, and not just applied research means just publish and somebody will apply it, but you have to take efforts in taking your solution out of your laboratory. Okay. See, now that's another mandate. It's not that I do some research, I develop some prototype, I say this is fine, it's working, I have shown proof of concept, that's it. No, I can't do that. So center wants this to go out. So find out how can we deploy it. Okay. So what did I say? The first activity is, of course, do research and then go out of the laboratory. Go to market. There is another activity which is the most important activity we have realized over the last 5 years. What is that? Go backward. Identify a problem. Identify a problem, identify a need, okay, right? Now, that's how our center is different from any other center in IIT or whatever research that happens, any applied research. So, when you do research for industry, now, who are the stakeholders? I said society, I didn't say industry. The difference, industry and society. Now, when industry comes to academic institute, it says I have a specific problem to work on, okay? I am facing this problem in my process, okay? Market wants this product with this feature. Can you come up with some way to do it with less cost, right? The problem is well identified. It is specified well, well defined, right? That is when I work with industry, right? But when I work with society, or when I work on socially relevant problems, who is going to come to me? Who is going to come to me? Who is the user of my technology? I told you some examples, right? Those who are sitting at the base of the pyramid are the users. Are they going to come to me? Will a farmer come to me and say that I am facing problem in my fertilizer pattern or whatever? I am not getting the yield required. I don't have water. Are they going to come to me? No. Okay. So, how do we identify a problem? We have to go out. We have to go out. So, that becomes another challenge, right? Okay. So, if I want to look at the impact of this, if I do something in laboratory and wants it to be deployed somewhere, first, I have to identify a problem, then work on it in laboratory, and then try and deploy it. Okay.
That is absolutely so that we have and find out their problems. Now, this is a very new idea to us also. One thing I want to know is that if I go and start anything, when you started this, did you do at first informally or did you do...
Okay, so there are... Good question. So, in fact, it's a main challenge, okay? How to identify a problem, okay? That we are struggling on that, still struggling. So that purpose of this talk is to tell your experiences, to tell your learnings. I am not going to tell you a model. I am not going to tell you some success stories, okay? Right? But the point that he raised was, how do you identify a problem? Okay? Informally or formally, are there methods to do that? There are methods. Okay? I'll come to that. I'll come to that. But at this juncture, try to understand, identifying a problem itself is a problem. Okay? It's a big problem. Right? Sometimes you see the problem is in front of me, but real problem is different. Okay? Right? And I say that I have a solution. Have you heard about this technology push and demand pull or need pull? Technology push means what? I do research in laboratory. I am specialized in, say, catalysis. Okay? I find some good catalyst for a particular reaction and I get fascinated. Okay? This is something that is going to solve a problem. And then I say I try and apply it everywhere and see whether it works. I am trying to push that technology, okay, without identifying the need. Okay? It may work sometimes, you are lucky, but that is not a way to go, right? If you really want to make an impact, you have to first identify the right problem, see whether the reaction is there for which this catalyst has to be used, and that reaction is conducted in industry, large scale, right? So this technology push is not going to work, right? But if you have some idea that, okay, fine, it may work, then there is a process to be followed before you start doing research in laboratory, and that is need identification. Okay? Sometimes it is called as customer discovery process. Customer discovery process. Okay? Try and go talk to all the stakeholders. Right? Do as many interviews as possible. Okay? And there is a technique to do that. So we have been doing that actually in IIT, and that is important element in the entire ecosystem. Very, very important. Okay? Right? Fine. So that means I can't sit in the lab. The projects have to be collaborative in nature. When I say collaborative, means I will not collaborate with any other researcher in some other academic institute. That's different collaboration. Here the collaborator is somebody who would help me identify a need, somebody who would help me deploy my product. Okay? So I have to identify the partners. Okay? In my research process. So the projects should be collaborative in nature, and of course that integrated approach of end to end. Okay. It's a virtual center. What does it mean, virtual center? Virtual center means it doesn't have its own academic program. So we don't admit students of Tata Center. Like, so, okay, it's a virtual center. That means you won't see a building of Tata Center also. You have visited lab and all, but then that's something, the space given to us, and we have established some facilities which are required for our purpose. Okay. But you know, separate, it's like chemical engineering, mechanical engineering, civil engineering and all. Okay. Right? So it's a virtual center. It's a new concept which is becoming very popular. It's taken again from Western culture. If you have an academic institute like IIT, there's so much research going on in different departments, centers, different verticals. If you want them to talk to each other, you should create such centers which are interdisciplinary and in nature, right? And it's very important, right, for your innovation entrepreneurship. It's really, really important that you should have people coming from different disciplines with different attributes working together to get your problem solved. Okay. So this is one virtual center, and we have few virtual centers in IIT as well, and they have its specific purpose, right? So it's a virtual center. It doesn't have its own academic program, but it draws faculty members and graduate students from various academic units in IIT Bombay. Draws means what? For example, students, they come to IIT Bombay either through JEE or GET, right? Or through PhD interviews, admissions. Once they get admission here, we interview them for Tata Fellowship, okay? So we give them extra fellowship in addition to what they get otherwise through MHRD. And we see whether they meet our requirement, and they will also know, okay, whether they really like to work on Tata Center projects or not, right? So we call them Tata Fellows. So they come from various departments and centers within IIT. And how do we draw faculty members from different departments? We give them projects. So we have, so it's like an internal funding agency. Tata Center is an internal funding agency, right? So we go for call for proposals. So different faculty members within IIT, they would submit proposals which will meet the requirement or which will meet the objective of Tata Center. What is the objective? Social interventions, right? Impact, scale, end to end. You should have willingness to work on need identification and deployment as well in addition to the research that you're doing, right? So with this objectives, like if somebody is ready to submit a proposal to the center, we fund that. Of course, we have a committee looking at evaluate and all that, right? So we draw faculty members. Now we have about 50 active projects going on at present. I'll give you some examples. And there are 50 plus faculty members because one project may have multiple faculty members associated with that. They're associated with the center, right? And the students are working on those projects. So now we do all these types because masters and PhD are supposed to do research work. So their research project is nothing but one sponsored by the center. The center doesn't stop here just by giving funds. Now it has to facilitate these two other parts, okay, like need identification and deployment, which is not part of our regular academic activities. So center has established certain facilities to do that. I hope it is clear. Shall we go ahead? Now I'll probably move faster. Now which areas do we work in? Almost all. So which are all national needs, no? And every area you see, like our country is really facing lots of problems, right? Agriculture, food, healthcare, water, waste management, sanitation, housing, and so on. There is no dearth of problems to work on in this. Good. Oh, so I should have mentioned that. Sorry. So basically, so as I said, no, it's collaborative in nature. So we always find partners. Now, in fact, there's some examples also. By just sitting in IIT, we won't be able to really give justice to these projects, right? So we are in search of right partners outside. As I said before, those who would help us in need identification and deployment, but at the same time, academic institutes. And there are a few projects in which we have our lab situated in some engineering college in rural areas.
Around the world, right.
India, right.
Because different states, they have different problems.
Right, yes. So for a particular project, we have a collaboration with that particular engineering college, okay? And the students of that engineering college also working on.
What is the procedure for this?
So we, this is again a bit informal. We conduct programs like this. In fact, there is a TICWIC program going on in Tata Center at present, okay? It's going on simultaneously, okay? And we try and, in fact, the purpose of giving this talk here is one of the objectives is to tell you about a center and see a possibility of, so it's becoming a bit, it's a bit informal, like letting people know about center, its activities and so on. And if you have any interest, we can take it forward, okay? You have people whom you can contact and try and understand more about it, right? But if there's any better way of doing it, just let me know, okay? We have our website, all the information that I can, we can give them handouts, okay? Right?
But what problem our state would
Identification of?
Who will finance it?
Funds. Yeah. That's the main problem everywhere. Right. That's what I'm saying. Yeah.
There are some regional problems also.
Okay. So now that you're talking about it, let me just jump to one slide. Now this is one project. Okay. What does it say? It's jaggery making. You know jaggery? Yeah, jaggery from sugar cane, right? And this plant that you see, it is situated not here in IIT. Okay. It is in a place called Varnanagar. Kolhapur district of Maharashtra, South Maharashtra. So like why I'm giving an example, because this is a project in which the entire plant, the funding has come from Tata Center. Okay. And our people are working in this plant, though appointed by Tata Center. At the same time, the college students and some faculty are also involved in this. Right. And we consider this as a successful model, right? Because you have an advantage. Okay, you have local people working with you. You are very close to society. Mm. We are all said and done, though we are in Mumbai, like ask many people how many times they go out of campus, like here. We are within ourselves, okay? It's a small town here, right? So all our needs are satisfied here. We don't have to go out, right? So it's better that we collaborate with others. All right, so I hope it is clear now. Then we have this structure, okay, I won't spend much time, but just to let you know, we have many committees and all that, because this work, if it is to be done, okay, in a very systematic way on relatively large scale in institute, then we need the governance structure for that, right? Funds, we have funds, but at the same time, we need right people to use those funds properly. So, we have a TCTD staff, you might have met some of them yesterday. So we have a laboratory, a prototyping facility, we have postdoctoral fellows working, we have project managers, of course, like as and when required, we appoint them for particular projects, a particular area rather. And then of course, we have a media team as well, because it's important, especially for deployment of products. Okay. We need media team. Internally also we have a newsletter coming out, and you have to make people aware of what you're doing. Now all of you would go on our list, okay? So you'll receive our newsletter. Okay. You may delete it if you're not interested, but then you'll, so media team does that work rather. And we have Tata fellows, I was telling you, then research staff and associate fellows. That means some people who are not direct Tata fellows, but only for a particular period they work on project. The three main activities of the center, research activities, curricular activities. I say it doesn't have its own academic program, but still we have some curricular activities and it's important. I'll talk more about that later. And then of course other activities. I'll start with curricular activities. What do we do? Now this is an entirely different domain. An engineer who or an engineering student, imagine, so these are all graduate students or rather they've come to IIT for post-graduation. Bachelor students, we don't have any direct link with bachelor students. They can work on some of the projects that are going on in the center. But otherwise, these are all graduate students, okay, who are coming to IIT. Now, what's the engineering education we give them and how? What's the social component in that? It's not much, right? So we need to sensitize them towards the social problems and the role of technology and design and management in that, okay? So what we have done is we have introduced few courses, okay? Luckily we have a school of management here, right? And through them we have introduced few courses for Tata fellows. Now Tata fellows are the fellows or students who are coming from different departments. They'll be doing their regular courses in the department. The students would get degrees in mechanical engineering, civil engineering and all, but since they're getting Tata fellowship, they need to do additional courses, okay, right? And we do lots of things in those courses. So we have introduced two courses, we call them as pro seminar. But of course, it's exposure to end-to-end innovation and whatever is required for that. Okay, so these are credit courses, so their grade will depend on that, right? And these are done in a very different way. It's not like classroom learning tutorials and all. Of course, it's all there. But what we do is most of the times we just get people. We call it a pro seminar. That means run in seminar mode. Okay. So we get people from outside to talk to them, okay, those who have really been successful in some social intervention, social entrepreneurs, okay, they come and interact with students, they tell their success stories, okay, and students are supposed to prepare a report, right? So all these activities, okay, is mostly that type of work, okay, and of course the research methods, need identification exercise, so students are exposed to this particular part. Then we have introduced a lab. And you have visited that lab, right? The prototyping lab. We have seen that in schools in India, like we don't get much exposure on working with hands. And that's really important if you want to come up with some innovation which involves prototyping, right? And our engineering students who have secured good marks in their exams, JEE, GATE, they're miserable when it comes to working with hands. Not all of them, right? And you agree with me, right? We ourselves, like I myself, like when I graduated, I never worked on lathe. Okay. Probably access is a problem, right? And again, you since you're doing your engineering in electronics, you may not work on lathe. If you're doing your engineering in mechanical engineering, then you may not do electronic fabrication, right? So this is a place where you'll see all the Tata fellows doing a lab. They make their own prototypes, right? And that is a credit lab for them, must. And these are all facilities that we have. And this is usage of lab, we keep monitoring. Then we have sophisticated instrumentation laboratory also, and this is under construction now. But we started purchasing equipment and all. So some of you might be aware of all this. Those who are working in chemistry, materials and all, like you have BET analysis, then gas chromatographs and so on, right? Sophisticated instruments, that's also important. Now this is where I'll spend some more time, research activities of the center. So as I said, like we go for call for proposals and the faculty would submit proposals and they are of different natures. Now these proposals would be either white paper proposals in which you're supposed to do some survey, okay, identify a need, okay, generate some data, do analysis, interpret it. What's the outcome? Outcome is a report. And report would say that these are the areas you really need attention from technology or design point of view. Right? So that's the purpose of doing white paper. Right? Small project. Right? So that may initiate problems. Then we have project which would do some laboratory research and come up with a proof of concept. If the results are encouraging, we fund it further, extension and then translation. So we have different levels as far as the projects are going on. Is it necessary that you start with white paper always? Not necessary. You can have entry at different points. And of course, your need identification, proof of concept, field level testing and scale up. I'll talk about it more in the next slide probably. So this is, as I said, the projects which are sponsored by center, on which there has to be one principal investigator from IIT.
Principal investigator.
But then there are other institutes which can collaborate with, this investigator may identify collaborators outside. Problems may be initiated by others, and you can approach some of the faculty members here and jointly submit a proposal. But IIT faculty has to be there as a principal investigator. See, once a project picks up, it's like even if the principal investigator is from IIT, it doesn't matter much, okay? Like those who are taking really working on the projects would probably take it forward, okay? So those designations of co-investigator doesn't matter. I've seen projects in which others are taking more interest than our, and he becomes only administrative person. But as long as progress is happening, everybody is happy. This is again important slide, okay? And why I want to, so see, a purpose of telling you about our activities is, again, as Professor Atre said, that we're trying to build an ecosystem which is conducive for entrepreneurship, innovations, and so on, right? So this is very important, and some of it is useful for you also. Like in your colleges also, something similar is being planned. Okay, of course, sometimes we may face constraints, as you said, in terms of funding and all, but at least we should have a clear picture, okay, what is required. And this is based on our learning, okay. It's probably not available in any textbook or something, okay. This is something that has come out of our experiences. So we have a core committee of Tata Center. There are about 8 to 10 faculty members. They meet almost once in fortnight, and then we have discussions on the ongoing activities and the future plans and so on. So this is something that we worked out as to see where the project is. Okay, now we call it as solution readiness level, and this term is used, we only call it solution readiness level, whereas if you go to CSIR labs and all, they use a term called technology readiness level, TRL, where we are calling it a solution readiness. It's not solution, can be in design also, right? Need not be in technology, right? Solution can be in management also. And it's important, if you want to make an impact, just don't restrict yourself to technology, because technology cannot answer all the questions, okay? So solution readiness level 1 and 2, so we have need validation. That means you come with a need, you said I know there is a need there, and based on that you write a proposal, but then we tell you later that, oh, go and talk to customer and tell us whether your need is, that you identified, is correct or not. Okay, so the group has to do this exercise, need validation, that Love will talk about later. Okay, need validation, that means need that you have identified is really correct or not. Sometimes you get answer no, okay, after doing this exercise. You have to stop there, okay, or you change your definition or change your need. Then come up with a basic prototype. And this is where you come back to center, say that fine, I have a basic prototype, proof of concept, work is progressed so much, give me more money, okay, to make a prototype which is, they call it a minimum viable, whatever, product, MVP, that's the jargon, right? So make a prototype which is ready for field test now. So that is SRL 3. So that's where we give them extension grant. Then the real exercise starts, and that takes real, and that's really challenging, because we have, if you see our projects, you know, so almost 75% of the projects are still at this level, right? And this is where you have to go out, you talk to your potential customer, not talk, you demonstrate your product, get a feedback, do iterations, as many as possible. So if you do one iteration, SRL 4, 2, SRL 5, and more than 2, that means 3 or more, SRL 6, till you get your product ready, right? And of course, after this, you have to translate it, you have to find market distribution channels, identify who would take your product out on large scale and all, that's translation analysis. And for socially relevant problems, you have different options, okay, different options. I have developed something, okay, and it is really going to make money, any industry will come and take it forward, okay. But then they would say, give me all IPs, right, associated with this innovation, right, and then it may not make an impact. It may sit with them, and it's their right to whether make a business out of it or keep it with them. Right? Is this the right way to take the solution forward, especially for socially relevant problems? No. Right? So we'll have to judge that. Okay. So there are options, even if you have a solution available and looks good, okay, you have to work on this. And this is a completely non-technical exercise. Engineers have to just raise their hands and find some other experts to give them consultancy on this. Right? And of course, when it goes, like you have this technology transfer, you can give it to industry if you want, and of course, with a most probably then non-exclusive rights. And of course, you can have your own startup, which is something that we're encouraging, right? And as I said in the beginning, these are all not market driven. Like most of them are like, I'll tell you the problems that we're facing. Like, though solution is good, economics also look good, but still it's not market driven. What does it mean? They're not going to experience huge profits. But it has a potential to make an impact, make lives better, especially at the base of the pyramid. So this is a very challenging exercise. And normal market driven, it's not that challenging. And of course, when you go to SRL 10, that means the product has really reached the market, it started making its impact, everybody is happy, right? Now, I'm sure you'll ask me a question now, how many such products are there at SRL 10, okay? The answer is zero, okay? At present, within 5 years, okay, getting a product or solution at this level, we have realized that it is impossible. So we have some projects here, right? I think next slide we'll probably talk about it.
Are there any time dependent projects? I mean, the center started 5 years back, and PI started working on a problem. Still it is not at the level or SRL 10. By the time it comes to SRL 10, the need of that product might have been, are there projects like this?
Yeah, there are. Time bound means what? Time bound, how will you define
time? They are relevant only for next 5 years or only
it happens. Years. It happens. So while judging the need and while some projects come to us, some ideas come to us and we realize that this is an immediate need and probably few years down the line something else. See, I'll give you an example. Somebody came up with some energy solution in villages, okay. Now, I am going to give an example relevant to that. And that was for power generation for biomass, right. It's a very important problem, okay. But tomorrow, if they get electricity everywhere provided by government, then possibly this solution is not going to be relevant. And if there are signs and if already it's happening, then we'll have to think about it. Okay, right. So while deciding whether this project should be funded or not, these but even after doing that, some projects face this problem later. Okay, but as I said, it's like we are here to create one or two success stories, right? But our aim is not to come up with all the projects going to the market, but to create human resources, okay. With this process, this is just a tool, okay. This is just a means, okay. While students are working on it, they will understand it very well, okay. And if our students go out with this background, they are more capable of handling these problems, okay. So that's how we look at it, okay. And even you are at this stage, okay, you have done some successful field trials, we still call that project to be successful, okay. Right, because the next ladder, next step is very high, okay, right, we call it valley of death or something, valley of death, right, and socially relevant problems where you are expecting mostly help from government and all, which are not market driven, that depth is even, it's more deeper, I would say, like, okay, and this graph tells you that. See, the solution maturity would be there. You can get a product with highly all the features and everything working very well, industry is interested, but it may not. So look at a graph on the top left. Sometimes the solution maturity is there, but the social benefits are not seen. I was giving you an example, okay. If the IP remains with the company and doesn't see huge profits, then fine, remains there itself, right. Somebody else has to take initiative to, so somehow the translation analysis is important. So that graph is meant to explain the translation analysis. So I was telling you, right, just to give you an idea, we started 5 years back and this is where we are, SRL 1, SRL 2, probably we advanced a bit further, this is made last year, I don't know, probably, yes. But this is the overall picture. We still call this as successful projects, okay, because they have gone to field. what I am trying to convey is it's a really challenging task. Okay, it's not so easy. Even if you put resources, there's funding available, but working in social space is not that easy. So what are the challenges? Challenges in terms of doing research in laboratory. Okay, from the point of view of a professor who is doing a project. Okay, you all are professors. I thought we'll try and understand. First of all, willingness to work in field. Important, no? For IIT professor, like all the resources are here. How much time do we have? How much time do we have?
One more hour.
I'm getting funding from DST, DBT, and all. Everything is coming to my lab. Students are available. I'm able to publish and all that. Why would I do this? There should be passion. Okay. So that willingness has to be there, right? So that is the necessary condition. Okay. When we get a project proposal, we look at that. Okay. And we make sure that the faculty is really willing. So faculty may say, okay, no, I'll develop a product, fine. Okay, at laboratory, I'll show proof of concept, give me money for that, and then my job is over. Then there's a problem. Okay, that willingness has to be there. Center is ready to help you take the product out, but that willingness is very important. And of course, the non-technical matters. Okay, you have to handle many of them. Okay, not directly yourself and spend your time and all that. You should be prepared to do that. Team building is important. It's a project, okay, and it has to be implemented in field. So doing a research project, otherwise I just need a student, I have to guide in day in, day out, whatever. We go in depth and come up with some knowledge and publish it. That's a different project. And this project needs so many people. And as I said, typically a Tata Center project will have Tata fellows, PhD students, Tata fellows, project staff we can hire on the project. So funding given to them, you are allowed to hire project staff. The industry or field collaborator, in that you may have other engineering colleges, like I gave an example. Interns, that's another area, you can send your students here. Okay. So we have internships for students. Okay. Right? Of course, you have to identify a proper project for that. And the last one, which is in red, something that we learned, okay, over the years, champion. Okay, who is this champion? He's really somebody who wants to take it. It's called fire under the belly. Like you should have passion, and you should love that problem that you're working on. And at most of the times, those who are interested in startups in social space are the champions. Need not be technical, okay?
Everyone who is starting.
So you should have somebody who would really drive this project out of lab. Now I'm going to talk about a gasifier project short while, and just giving an idea how many people are working on this. It's a big thing, right? So just quickly going, so now you'll get an idea as to what projects we're working on. This is one on mushroom cultivation, which is already technology transfer has happened. Idea is the investigator, she developed a spawn. Why mushroom? It's basically providing livelihood option for farmers, especially in villages, not necessarily farmers. In fact, the women, okay, they can start their own business. So they're working with SHGs. Self-help groups, right? And everything is worked out. Look at economics, like you have to invest some 30,000 and all the scheme, and government is already funded. Okay. So there are three locations in which already the project is started. Proof of concept is shown on a large scale. Needs microbiology input. At the same time, constructing this facility needs mechanical engineering inputs because we need some energy. We are driving it from solar source. Okay, so some few people have got together to get going on this. This is from healthcare. This is to identify bilirubin, okay, for neonatal jaundice. Most of the time you take samples from babies. Okay, it's very painful for them, right? Can we have a unit, okay, which is non-invasive, take pictures and identify. There's some programs and all. This has gone already a startup on this. cervical cancer screening, I think Zubin will talk more about it. Maybe I will come back to this and then I'll finish my talk. And this is again one very promising project, or rather done a lot of, I would say it has gone beyond lab. Not just that, the trust, Tata Trust has invested money in conducting trials. Zubin will say more about it. I hope you know what cervical cancer is, and there are many people who are suffering from this, right? And some, most of the times detected at much later stage, and then there's a problem. And if you identify a disease, you have to actually cure it, right? Just identifying and telling somebody that you have cancer has no meaning, right? So there should be effective way of doing it. And in fact, the same group is working on telepathology framework. Okay, that means somebody sitting in village, okay, the information has to be sent to a doctor sitting in the city, right? And of course, it has to be done in a very effective way. High resolution images have to be sent so that doctor can take a decision. You're not engaging doctor for a long time, so you're saving, you're providing services at lower cost. This is microscope identifying cells, and of course, there are many like display, magnify, capture, store and transmit high quality images. Okay. This is another related to housing or energy rather. So you have cool roof coating. That means many places you have so much heat, right? You can't afford air conditioner. You can put coating on your roof, and the reflection will make sure that you don't have so much heat transmitted to the room. Okay, and this has also gone out, and there's a startup on that. And this is one that I was talking about, jaggery making. Basically, jaggery, as you know, it is a cottage industry, and many farmers live on jaggery. Okay, of course, much of the sugar cane goes to sugar factory, but those farmers who cannot sell their sugar cane to sugar factories, who are these farmers? They are away from sugar factory, right? They are somewhere in the hilly area, right? And the number is not small. There are some farmers who want immediate cash, okay? Because sugar factories will make you wait for 6 months, probably. Okay, so even if you get less cash, it's okay, but I want immediate. Okay, so these are resource constrained or even bottom of bottom. Okay, right, farmers. Can we do something for them? This is on malnutrition. So the idea is to tell you a variety of problems that we're working on. Okay, and this is again a big problem. We have done. We found out. They call it RUTF. What is it? Ready to use therapeutic food. Okay, so come up with some formulations which are nutritious for severely or medium malnourished kids. Okay, so that we have run a big pilot in Dharavi, and the results are quite encouraging here as well. And with locally available, so it's like. So if you go by WHO or like standards, okay, they would say you should give groundnut, whatever, okay. And probably the kids may not like it, or it's not available, it's very expensive or something, right? So there's a need to come up with a formulation which is reasonably low price. Anyway, it is government would take care of the expenses, because these are all people who won't afford to spend money on nutritious food. But for government also, it's not. Government is also not rich, right? So, coming up with an affordable RUTF. This is another area in which we are working, waste management. Now, waste management per se is not for bottom of the pyramid, but it is for everyone, right? It is for everyone. In urban, in Mumbai also, we are facing a lot of waste management issues, right? So, why we have included in Tata Center? Because this is not market driven, okay? So, it's like, which is not market driven, we are going for it and see whether we can really come up with some good findings, right? So what we are doing here is, in fact, we have taken IIT Bombay campus as a test bed, okay, which is a population of 20-25K, it's not like a small town, okay, and we want to make the campus zero waste, okay. I've been saying this for last 3 years, many presentations, we want to make a campus zero waste, It still not happened. It takes time. It takes time. Okay, we need a lot of support from. And though we are in IIT, like, I am a colleague sitting there who are going to approve our proposal to do it for IIT Bombay, but still a lot of convincing required there. Okay. So this is something that I can talk on and on as to what are the problems apart from technology. So it's like integrated waste management solution wherein we try and treat each component of the waste. Now you say wet and dry, but in dry also you have plastic, you have cardboards, you have dry garden waste, right? So many things. Okay. So we are going to create a facility in campus, demonstrate that each component of waste is somehow treated, okay, as effectively as possible in terms of if you get some money out of it, it's good, okay. But you want to show a sustainable model working for waste management. Many cities have started doing that thanks to Swachh Bharat drive, but still there are lots of problems. Okay, so this is about our research. Now, last one, of course, not many slides, other activities. So we get students to work on different things. Our Tata fellows, apart from the courses that they do, we take them out because most of us are coming from the upper class, right, and not seen the real India, right. So we take them out to villages. Sometimes they stay with people, okay, and try and understand the problems that they're facing. Okay, we have something called as TCDD Yatra. That means they go out for about 10 days or so. We identified different places in the country where some good work is happening. So students would go and try and understand. We faculty members also travel with them. Right? So with that, students get more exposure. Then we have outreach. We have interns. We have CPs. CPs is continuing education programs like the one that's happening now. Okay. We have our own CEP program in which we do all this. In fact, in that CEP program, we'll have lectures on each case study, right? The one that I gave you some examples, right? There are only few of them. Okay, there are 50 projects going on. So the faculty members working on individual projects will come and tell their experiences, right? And of course, in that program, we'll have a laboratory. That means the participants would do a small project also in the lab. Okay, in fact, that's going on at present. We conduct competitions. This was done earlier. We have discontinued it and want to come back with some better way of doing it. It attracted a lot of attention and all, but we're not quite sure how it is going to be useful for the center. So, but we conduct something similar to hackathons and all. We have internship programs. Again, it's quite relevant to you. Like, if you have any students who would be interested in our the kind of activities that we do and the projects that we do, you can send them here. Okay.
How much duration?
Internships is during the vacation typically. In the summer or winter, like it all depends. Like, so it's all flexible. And sometimes we have seen students coming for 6 months. Okay, as a part of their master's project, right. And we encourage that as long as students are sincere, okay, really passionate. So there is this MIT in USA to whom Tatas have given funding, okay, and they wanted the center. There is a Tata center in MIT as well, okay, and it started before IIT. And the reason why MIT, because somehow the innovation culture in USA, especially places like MIT, is really good, and there's a possibility that we work with them and try and bring that innovation culture here. Okay, that's the overall philosophy behind it. And there's MIT center, and which has a similar structure as of the one that we have. Of course, slight differences are there, but these are the activities that we do. We interact with MIT Tata Center. Our fellows go there every year, okay, for a particular period and try and understand how they work, okay, and what are the things that are missing in our ecosystem. Okay, we try and understand that. We interact with the faculty members. They also go there, and their faculty members come here. Every year we have a joint meeting and so on. So this is about Tata Center. If you have any observations, points, doubts, whatever, we can take a small break, probably it's required, right? Any comments? Like,
can you elaborate about that social visit of the students that you have told?
Mm-hmm.
How do you actually arrange it? Do you identify some group of students and
right.
Where do you actually send them?
Where they are actually working with people in their own locality, trying to solve local problems, not really running for a high-tech solution, but trying to solve problems at very bottom level.
That's all right. I was just inputting is that what are the venues you choose?
Yeah. So one he said is Agastya Foundation, which is so we actually go in one direction because logistically we can't really go in every part of the country. So last year we went up to Madurai. Okay. So we visit a place called there's a Deshpande Foundation in Hubli.
Yes. Hubli.
Hubli. We went to Goa. There's a waste management facility there where they claim that Goa is or part of the Goa is now waste free, right? Then
Akshay Patra
in Karnataka, right? There's a community kitchen there. Madurai, there's some education. I personally didn't travel. The faculty traveled with the students different, so I don't remember the recall the names rather. Maybe I can get them for you. And there are details available. You can visit the web page. I think probably it's mentioned on the web page also, right? So basically, these are all NGOs and foundations, or sometimes Selco. Selco, you know, so Selco,
Bangalore.
Okay. So these are the organizations which are doing good work in social space. Okay, and there are people who can enlighten our students, telling their experiences, problems that they face, challenges that they face. Right. So, we approach them and the typical, see the way it happens is like our group would go there, then from their side there will be lecture, they will give orientation and all that. At the end of the day, our faculty members would sit with the students and do recap, okay, reflections, okay, and have some discussions based on what is being taught to them in the courses, okay, and link that with the things that they see, okay, and students are supposed to submit a report and give presentation at the end of it, rather. And there's so much learning that happens. Okay. Of course, again, need some funding for that, travel and other things. Luckily, center has funds allocated to that for that activity. Huh.
So, one of the faculty must be the investigator.
Right.
You will nominate that because we are submitting a project to the Tata Center.
Right.
Before itself, we need to identify.
Before itself, the submission has to be from IIT faculty member. But then you can approach me or center. Rather, you can go to center web page and there's a contact. You say that you are interested in this area. Center may help you connect with the right faculty member in IIT, and if and arrange meeting with the faculty member. Then you together can decide. What would be the role of individual partner, and then submit a proposal jointly. It has happened in the past. That's one mechanism. Okay. Otherwise, you can directly contact some faculty member, not necessarily through us. Okay. But a proposal has to come from IIT because that's for administrative purpose. It's important.
It will be easy through you, through the center.
Right. It will be easy. Yeah. Fine. Right. So you can submit one page write up on what you want to do. Then our people will connect you or to the right people in IIT.
Because you were planning the waste management in the institute.
Right.
A similar thing if we are planning, how can we connect?
Right. So that's a purpose. So it's like there are some solutions that we have developed here. We are implementing in IIT, somewhere else also. But I want to do it in some other city as well and of a different size. Okay. And if somebody from that city is ready to collaborate with me, then I have my presence there, right? Like, so that way it helps us a lot, and during this process, the partner will also get benefited, not just the professor or faculty, but the students as well.
Right.
Right.
So submit the proposal in the DST and the other.
Right, right.
So why not we are submitting the proposal?
So you can send it to us. The only thing is, the challenge here is to get a right IIT Bombay faculty member to.
Right.
So, huh. So that's how. Yeah, but faculty would always say, does it match my research interest? See, I also have some projects with Tata Center, okay? But they are in line with the research that I do, okay?
But every city having these problems like this.
No, problem is there, but are we the right people to work on it? That's what the faculty would think about it. But definitely, yes, problem is there, need would be there, but you need a right person from IIT side to work on it, rather like, for Tata Center to get involved in it.
Directly,
it's a bit difficult.
But sir, is he handled to then Tata Center is handled to this proposal, then weekly and monthly meetings they will.
So that happens. So that's what I'm saying. Sometimes, no, the initiative
the
and entire work is done by the partner. Huh?
The professor is not agree to IIT. So this project is how to.
Yeah, right. So that's a problem.
So
there are, yeah, say it. We can't work on all the problems, right? There are many problems around us.
Okay, it's realistic. So Tata persons, then other faculty members, is also the faculty in the reputed institutions anyway.
Right, right.
They can directly come. Why not?
No, but that, see, Tata Center is part of IIT. Okay. So are you saying Tata Center should give funds to any other college without, that's where the problem is. For administration purpose. Otherwise, informally we can work. You are always welcome.
But some funding is also required.
So independently funding cannot be, because there are other issues, no, accounting and others, right? Many issues are there. So funds cannot directly go to the, it can go through a PI.
But many organization funding research organizations is there.
DST is a, that is a government department. Tata Center is not a department. It is a donation given to IIT Bombay. It is part of IIT.
But if Tata Center is referred to the DST, this project is
That can be done.
To DST,
That is that can be worked out. Yes, yes. That
it's
can
a process. It's an easy process. But DST directly don't give me. But if the Tata Center is also included in this project, directly give me.
Yeah, but who? Tata Center means who? There are some faculty, right? Like, otherwise, there should be some co-investigator name should come in your proposal, right? When DST would need a proposal.
Everyone don't know the who is working on this field and who is interested. The IIT fellows is working on this field.
The best thing that can happen is you send your ideas, interest, or whatever.
I have an interest in the traffic management.
So one possibility the Tata Center can do is just send a one-page write-up. Then our people will try and connect you to the right people in IIT. And then try and arrange the meetings and whatever, okay. Then it's up to you and the concerned faculty to kind of decide as to what.
In this project, PI is at IIT fellow.
Right.
So I am co-PI in this.
Co-PI. It doesn't matter. So I've seen many projects in which.
If the PI is the Tata fellow.
Right.
It's okay.
Yeah. Suggestions. So basically, it's Data Center is part of IIT Bombay. It's like any other center of IIT Bombay.
We want to the center in our colleges, our institutions.
Right. If that happens, it's good.
If the Data Centers collaborate, IIT and
probably
our colleges centers.
Yeah.
Also
if a center grows to a particular stature tomorrow, If Data Center is part of every college, that would be the ideal thing to happen. But I don't know whether we have the Tata Trust has those many resources.
Some colleges.
Funding is a problem, right?
Our basic research also.
No, basic is not encouraged here. If somebody says that I want to understand and write a simulation model for something and all, that is not encouraged here. Though it is important, Tata Center is not the right place for that.
Your emphasis is only for a product development.
Product, process, any intervention rather. Okay. Any
at
intervention.
The end of the project completion, if revenue is generated, money is generated,
money generation, so basically when it goes to commercial stage, Tata Center will be out of it, okay. It's like any other center in IIT. So whatever IIT norms are there, right, So it's like if I want to transfer a tech, so I develop something and somebody is interested in commercializing it. I transfer a technology, okay, with some percentage of the revenue coming to IIT for research, okay. It will come. So center will not get it, IIT will get it. So because center is part of IIT, a technology transfer. If a startup happens, then again it's a new startup and start generating revenue, then some part of it will come to us.
Product we need to develop, already it is in the market, but it is at high cost.
Mm-hmm.
If we are trying for at a low cost.
Low cost, yes.
So such type of...
Yes. In fact, substitution for imported products is something that we look at, and there are a few projects going on. For example, there is a project on what? Silver paste in solar panels, right? And we are importing a lot of like the silver nano particles in that paste. We are importing it. Yeah, right. All right. So Zubin will talk about cervical cancer, the device that they have come up with, and the problems, challenges that they are facing, successes also.
Hi. So I think majority of the what the next slide is there, as sir has already told about it, that we emphasize more on doing the problem identification and need validation. And that is what the process we follow. So I'll just start with the project, what is it about. So it's a, so there are many types of cancers around the country which are floating around. So the main intention is at times doing in this process of innovation, we misguide our problem statements. So we don't stick to a crisp problem statement which misleads our innovation and at times doesn't, we are not able to create an impact over it also. And that is why it is very much essential to ask what problem is this, whose problem is this. So cervical cancer was being chosen because there are around, like if you can see the statistics, 1 lakh death in the year, in 1 year is happening. And it's not that there is no solution already existing in it. There is an existing solution there in it. And we all know that it has been, it is curable if detected early, but HPV virus is something where it has not been seen, it has not been reflected on your skin, or any kind of symptoms are not been shown out. So people hesitate that if we have this mindset that kuch nahi ho raha hai, toh fir kyun check karane jaate hai? Like, why do we go for the screening? I don't think there's anything wrong as of now, it is happening. And treatment cost at later stage is very high. So it is necessary to get a preventive measure at early stage. Globally, there are like around 27% cases of this. And so what we identified is, we don't at this stage, we are not looking at curing the disease. What are we looking at is, how can we do the screening of it? So our whole problem was, we want to do the screening of cervical cancer. So as you see, there is this kit already been there which does the screening, but the point is this cost for 2,000 rupees. So 2,000 rupees to spend for a woman, not in Bombay, but consider in some rural area, is very much challenging. Like, you might be seeing their monthly earning would be around 5,000, 6,000 rupees on an average in some rural context. And then how do you get that price point and how do you face this challenge where you can get it at lowest as possible. And generally what is already been used is this pap smear test. So pap smear test is what is, the cervix has been opened and a tissue has been teared from the cervix. Consider in some rural area, this tissue cannot be seen in some laboratory because there's no laboratory in rural area. And so we need to send those slides to some district level hospital, which will be around 4,000, 5,000 kilometers away from that city, from that village. It will take around like a month or two to tell the actual results of it, provided the slide is made well and been sent well. So there are a lot of gaps already in this traditional method which is there. And what the next stage, so this what we do is we initially we identify that what is the current process being followed to solve this problem. We as of now we have not jumped to solution what we want. So what they do, if you have been identified that there are some pigments of cancer in it, they visit to some public health office. The doctor does visual examination of the cervix. visual examination. So there is no record being made. The record is being made by, so the record is just how you see on paper, the cervix has been drawn and that's how it has been stored. So here also we are seeing some kind of lack of information transfer which could happen. So this is the traditional method which has been followed. So a doctor will view the cervix from visual examination and it will mark on the paper that there are chances of cancer pigment on this quarter of the cervix. So then we started to think about, okay, now what do you think are missing in this process? So there is a traditional process. What is missing in that process? In that process, we identified there is, so when we went to Assam and these all status, majority of people didn't even know that there is something called a cervical cancer. There's no image transfer or record transferable because those papers might be lost somewhere, or there's no digital record being made which can be preserved well. There are no trained professionals because you require a trained professional to make that slide. That slide making is also challenging. Affordable result, as you know, that kit will cost 2000 rupees. Of course, nobody is going to buy that thing. On spot result was not available. And awareness also is a big challenge because when you do these kind of camp, you get to know that people are not even aware that there is this type of cancer already there. So then we thought that, okay, what can be removed from this is, if we want to remove this whole paper and visual examination, we need to digitalize the cervix so that that can be stored. And also if you have been, if in case any of your connected people would have been going through this, in the treatment of cancer, these people tend to change hospitals in terms of not getting a right treatment. And when they change these hospitals, we have to do the preliminary test again. These preliminary tests cost some time and there is some money involved in it. If these were being digitalized, you just have to transfer the data to them. And now since Aadhaar, from the time we have got Aadhaar card, there's soon going to be a Aadhaar medical wallet where all your data would be stored there. So what, when you change hospital, you just have to give your Aadhaar card and the data would be shared there. So a lot of time and money would be saved if this digitalization has been done. So yeah, so then we started to look, okay, we got to know that what is missing in the current traditional method, and we started looking out, okay, we might not be the first people who is going to invent or develop it. There's already some existing solutions. So what are those solutions? So Sweden made something which is currently costing for 3 lakh rupees. Israel has made something which is 1.25 lakh. And there are other these solutions. Okay, I cannot take that computer and that whole thing to Assam to do in some boot, some campsite, or that wire thing, that wire might cut off and we are not able to do that. So then how, so there are existing solutions, but there are, each of them have their own different set of challenges, cost or comfortability, portability. And then we started doing prototyping about what can be the ideal solution where we can get a cost effective thing. It is portable enough. It is rugged and affordable also, in terms where, of course, if I built a gadget sitting in my lab and that would cost around 2 lakh rupees and then go to Assam and apply lo, nobody is going to buy that in Assam considering the cost. So we need something almost at 1/10 of that price. So after almost a good amount of prototyping, we landed to this first first field trial model. So this model was able to capture images. This has a zoom lens and an optics inside it, a CMOS camera, where it is able to capture images. It has its own light source because these are being handled in some campsite. There might be no light or no electricity there, so you need it. It is battery operated, so there's no need of live electricity. And there is a USB and battery and SD card in it, and we thought this is the ideal solution and we thought we have cracked the problem. But at times what is challenging is it's not that every time the technicality would solve the problem. So I'll tell you what was missing in this gadget. So we made this whole complete kit where a tripod can be kept and you put the device over it. It is USB charging. Everybody can do that USB charging. And you all would be feeling that this is the ideal solution because yeah, clicking images, we are doing it digitalizing and everything is happening well and it is portable enough, right? So we also thought this, we made 20 copies of these gadgets and gave out to doctors in around the country. So these are the some of the samples. So what acetic acid or glucose is being used as the dye, where it will be used on the patient, which can reflect the cancer cells. And acetic acid was, so glucose is something where if I run short of glucose in Assam or some Rajasthan, I won't get it. But acetic acid is something which will, I'll get it all over the place. So a reason why there was two of these. So these were the places where we gave out these copies, and we gave them to a few duration that, okay, use it and tell us that how it is and what changes are required, etc., etc. So we got feedback, okay, maybe we need to change the light because light is yellow. Some doctors preferred it white. So everybody started giving their different solutions also in it. Also, one more challenge what we identified is, today I have gone to Assam, I have trained the technician or doctor, of course no gynecologist is there. So I've trained the technician to do this test, do the screening. So today I am present and I'll be able to teach him or her. Tomorrow, consider after 6 months, if there is, the person has been changed due to some kind of reason, how do you transfer the information there? So what we found out is there is a need of educating these women about how to use these gadgets, because you never know, might people would change there, and also just to have an well information. So we started preparing different video tutorials of these gadgets in different languages. Because me being Gujarati, if I go in Assam and I start talking high jargon English or Gujarati, nobody's going to understand that. So we need in different languages so that it is able to also transfer information to one another in absence of mine as a technical person there. So, you know, it's at times these technical, at times problems cannot be solved only being an engineer or a technical person. You need some different sources also. So we got a media team into it and prepared these video tutorials, how languages would be more efficient. So then we landed to this pro and basic version. Before telling to this, when we gave those 20 copies, you know what we identified, that there was technically that gadget was very well, but there was a behavior change required to use that gadget because it had an SD card in it. So doctors were also a little lazy to remove that SD card and send images. And also the another problem we got to know is, so there are no doctors also. At times there are no doctors, there are technicians who are doing this. So there was also error being found where, consider I clicked an image, that image has been by default given some number, that image number IMG238. That is of the subject X. Since there is a camera who is just clicking images, I have to somewhere relate that, okay, that image is of this person and second image is of this person. If by mistake I create an error of 234 of X person and 235 of Y person, where that was the incorrect one and that was of the Z person, then I might run someone into problem telling her that you have cancer when she didn't have. So then how do you challenge? You have been challenged by the problem which is not at all technical. Like, how do you change this behavior problem of a person being an engineer? So then what we found out is there is some technological change. What we made into it is we converted that to a phone version where you have an app to it. That previous device didn't have an app. It had a camera which will click images, had an own optics. Here we brought in an app to it where you put in the name first, you put in the Aadhaar number first, and then the camera will open, unless the camera won't open. So there is no chance where I'll click an image and then put a name and then might run into some kind of error. So at times you might never know that what you think is the ideal solution won't be the ideal solution. Also, to balance, since I've written that business model thing, this is something where it was a bit different in terms of converting it to a business model also. Like how sir said, in social space it is not necessary that all projects would convert to a for-profit commercial startup. So then how do you, and but there was a need for it, that is for sure. Because still, if you consider the weightage where Tata Hospital is bearing, considering so much short amount, so many less number of doctors, and in terms of the line of patients what are there, there is some kind of technological change which is required there. And then how do you balance this using that? We could not create something, a high value product also. This product was needed in all states, irrespective of who is going to use it, but the need is there for sure. And we all know that if I ask some of you that, will you be happy to run a startup where I will sell the gadget at only 25,000 rupees? How do you start a company like this? Because I know that someone in Rajasthan or Assam won't buy it for 1 lakh rupees, right? And our point was that it reaches to masses. Then how do you crack this problem? Like, any guesses you want to try? I think somewhere the hint was there in the first PPT where sir gave it. So the idea is very novel. It is solving the problem. For sure it is giving us the result. Only thing is you have to make it to reach to masses. So then
giving training to more people.
Yeah, training was absolutely free because we will push those videos to YouTube and people can see it. But then how do I equip someone to buy this gadget at 25 where I can sell it at 25? And then we found out that we cannot build as of now a for-profit startup. We have to somewhere draw in CSR funds, as in where, if you would have noticed, this is actually doing two things. It is educating women about knowing cervical cancer, and on the other hand, it is trying to solve this problem of doing early stage screening, which was being able and which helped us to acquire CSR fund, because there are two problems being solved at one project. And so we got CSR fund to get these models built. We are in the process of building around 70 copies and give it away to doctors in all these states. So somewhere it is not necessary to build a $1 billion project or a $1 billion startup. At times you have to go down and see to the crux of it, that how can you spread it to the other states and yet create an impact. Of course, if your ambition is to do a $1 billion product, this project is not that. But yeah, then this CSR actually helped us, because now someone has funded us to make 75 copies of this. Also the telepathology thing, because problem is not solved here, right? We have only screened the cervix and we are only able to identify it. And then we jumped up to so this is actually the final model. It's a mobile version which has an app. It clicks pictures. The best part of this is any woman can do this, because everybody are very much familiar to pinch, zoom and clicking pictures through phone. I don't need a gynecologist to run from Bombay to Assam to do the screening, because I can click pictures and send it to her and tell her to relay back what is the result. Cloud, exactly. Phone data I'll use and send it there. So the load on gynecologists to run around the city is also reduced. Also, we have been equipping and educating other women in the city, that other women in the villages, that is also happening here. And one problem has been solved, not by reaching there and still being able to impact masses. So the business model also we started thinking upon, that how do you create, eventually we might have to create and consider, okay, if I make a subsidized model to give it in Assam and all these states where you need a low price point, might as well create a high price point product and sell it at high price point, and that would subsidize the cost of product which we can give it at rural areas. Where the trial was done, these places. Yeah, so the consent, so every time, so every, consider if someone is a doctor, we go to him and ask him that this is the gadget. Every time he does the screening, he has to put in a consent form to the patient that this is a gadget and there is a trial being on, and are you consent to fill in this trial form for it, and if you are required, then only this trial happens.
So you're using something,
acetic acid, yeah.
So you're putting it into the body.
Yeah.
So ethics committee, clinical trial.
Huh, so when we do this clinical trial, that consent form is required that patient is okay with these norms. So there are norms being specifically mentioned to it.
Only patient consent is enough for this?
Yeah, patient consent has to be there.
Only patient consent is enough?
Yes.
I think there's some ethics committee approval.
Ethics committee approval, which happens on the wider part of it. So now when we, so consider this is one of the project which has reached to SRL, I think we can say it's 7 or 8.
What about the security?
Data security. Data security is something, because since Aadhaar is yet not been there. So as of now, we are at stage where we are ourselves collecting the data. Because what happens is we are trying to put in image processing to it. So where we have a stack of 50,000 images which are cervix infected, cancer affected, and then we try to do image processing over it and then push the result out.
Machine learning?
Eventually we have to, like, everything is going to lie down to machine learning. We have not yet included the machine learning part to it, because somewhere this also is a trade-off where you want to cut down the employment of many other people who are involved in it. So this is a trade-off which we are currently at, that should we add machine learning, because the other project of telepathology is something where machine learning is being supposed to include, but as of now we have not been Yeah.
If you get that done before the age of 40, then you don't get the chance of having a cervical cancer. So any woman who is below 40 years of age can get vaccinated for this.
Yeah, there are vaccines available, but then consider the past generation, people, they are not very much aware also about it, and even after awareness, people have not been taking that. In India? Oh, in India, the registered death is 1 lakh. The registered death. There are, of course, unregistered death. But in India, the registered death is only 1 lakh, which is very much big.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Thanks, Zubin.
He came here for a very short notice. They requested me to get in touch with him and ask him whether he can spend some time. So thanks a lot.
Yeah.
So this is another example from healthcare. I'll take you to this particular project comes under waste management. It comes in energy and many kind of overlapping areas. I'll just skip this. Talking about agro waste. Now, when I say agro waste, what is it like? So if you take the useful part out from your farm product, what remains is agro waste, right? So thrash and all, okay. So it depends on crop, okay, which crop you are dealing with, and you can get so much unwanted stuff and you don't know what to do with it. And this is a very typical problem, especially paddy, wheat, right? You get a lot of thrash. And people, the farmers are not aware of what is to be done with this. So what they do, they just burn it off, right? So I've done harvesting, and there's so much waste that's available. I have some 10-15 days within which I need to kind of dispose it, right? So that's a typical situation the farmer has, and only solution is burning it, right? And what's the problem burning it? The problem is
pollution.
And you are, and at the same time, it's an asset, right? You're burning it, so much energy, you're wasting it, right? There's a belief that by burning it, you're generating heat and there are some microbes killed in the soil and all. But along with some bad microbes, you're killing good microbes also. So there is no scientific proof behind that. So let's not say that, fine, it is helping the soil, okay? At least some of them, some of the cases, it might be giving good results and all. But look at what this farmer says. He says that we have so much waste available, why can't government take it, okay, and give some revenue, okay. So, and again, like every time we have to call government to do it, like, and government is also resource constrained and it cannot really do much, right? And that's a problem. And this Delhi-Punjab problem is also quite well known, right? Punjab is so much burning happening, and because of which Delhi there is pollution. But it's not just Delhi, just because Delhi it has come to limelight, because there are many places it's happening, okay? So, what do we need to do? Of course, this is air pollution. One solution. Now, first, it's like I'm not saying that this is the solution, okay? Somehow the problem is so big, there's so much biomass that is generated, we need to find multiple solutions for that, okay? So now the government has started taking initiatives, okay? They're trying to use this biomass for power generation. Now what we are looking at, a solution that we are proposing is, can I use it for cooking? Now, what is used in for cooking today, especially in rural area, it is wood, okay? Or otherwise, now government is saying we are supplying LPG everywhere and all. Still, that day has not come yet, where LPG supply is everywhere. So, somewhere LPG has gone and people are using LPG. What we are proposing is this, that can we use something called as gasifier, which is a better way of using this agro waste, okay? Now, now this is a picture of gasifier, okay, it looks, and in that corner you can see, this is a typical chula, that is being used in many community cooking places. So, we are not suggesting that you should use this gasifier for domestic cooking, okay, because such a big thing there, like nobody would like to have in kitchen, right? So, we are saying that for community places, community cooking places, can we make use of this, okay? So, with this idea, we started working on it and we are at some stage right now. Where is this agro waste used today? Of course, animal fodder is the best use of it, okay? If we are able to use it for animals, go for it. But not all is used by animals, okay? And again, depends on the crop, okay? If it is cotton stock, then animals won't eat it. There's so much lignin in that, okay, there's a problem. People are using it for cooking purpose, but very inefficient way, okay, and very, like, it creates a lot of pollution, okay. Some people are burning it, as I said, for soil and all, right, and of course, unintentional, rather purposely burning it just to get rid of it. So, how do we want to use this agro waste for cooking purpose? We want to use it in this particular form, pellets, okay. Something that you have probably come across. Now, the challenge here is, now, making pellet is fine, but there's a cost associated with it. And how do you use pellets for cooking purpose in an efficient way? So, there is an opportunity to develop a rural agribusiness revolving around these pellets, okay? How do we make pellets? Take waste, okay? Then you have to shred it. Before that, separate the soil from it, because it's waste, it's not just pure biomass. And then shred it as many times as possible, okay? Then pelletize it and you get pellets. Where do we use pellets? Now forget about cooking. I told you initially it's cooking, but otherwise, now when I make pellets, what is the possible use of pellet? Pellet can be used for as an energy source, right? Now it can be substitute for coal, it can be substitute for fuel oil, right? So it can be used in industry, right? As a source of energy. I can run a boiler using pellets, right? Or briquettes, right? But then why it is not happening then, okay? If it is so easy, if it is so market driven, then why people are not doing it, okay? There's so much agro waste available in this country, it's a problem for us. Government should have taken initiative to do it. Why it is not happening? Because it is not market driven, it is not economically viable, because industry would go for the cheaper source. If I make pellets, there's a cost associated with pellet, and if the crude oil prices go down, then what will happen? Then the fuel oil will be available at a cheaper price, and then I will not buy pellet as an industry person, right? So there's a fluctuating market for pellets. I can't establish a facility to generate or to make pellets on large scale. And that's why many projects have become unsuccessful, economically unviable, and they had to close down. Okay, right? So the idea was, fine, if I'm not able to use it in industry, can I use it for cooking purpose at community cooking place? Okay, so that's where we started looking at it. Okay, so the present market, as I said, is a small scale industry as a fuel. Okay, but the market is limited. So as I said, can we go for cooking purpose? Now, what do they use now? They use wood or LPG, right? Then why would they buy pellets, and why would they use pellets? The thing is, wood, what is the problem with wood? It results in deforestation. Is the consumer bothered about deforestation? It's not bothered about it, right? That means government has to come in, okay, to avoid the use of wood, okay, for cooking purpose, right? Because deforestation has its own problems, okay, society is suffering because of that. LPG, its availability is an issue. Go to rural areas, still it has not reached. The fact is that it has not reached every household or community cooking places. And the cost is also an issue. So that means I need to look at pellets, its cost, and see whether they can replace either LPG or wood. Okay. Now, how do we use pellets? Just burn them? If we burn them, then they have problems. Okay. If just combust it, then it's like wood is cheaper, because even if deforestation is not allowed, illegally is happening everywhere. Okay. People are using wood. It is a better source. Now, I have not told you how these pellets are different from wood. I will come to that. But then if you just burn them, there is a release of volatiles. Okay. And there are emission problems. Efficiency is less. Okay. Just by burning in chula. And chula has its own problem, that you might have heard about it. There is so much particulate emissions, so many people are, their lives are going down because of that, unknowingly, right? So, I have 5-10 minutes, right? So what we are suggesting, instead of burning them directly, use them in gasification mode, okay? Now, what is gasification? Gasification is, you have carbon and hydrogen present in solid form. What is agro waste? It basically cellulose, lignin, okay, and it's hydrocarbon with some oxygen in it, right? Try and take that hydrogen and carbon out somehow and use it as a gas, a heating gas. If you burn it, you will get some energy out of it. It is called as gasification. Okay. So we are proposing gasification as an alternative to combustion. Okay. So what will happen with this? It will increase the efficiency. The way we are doing it, we are increasing the efficiency of using, that means I need less amount of fuel. I was burning wood openly, the efficiency was less. Now if I use it in gasification mode, any biomass, I am able to increase the efficiency and need less amount. And we have proven that, okay, we'll come to some results. So, but then as I said, can I use gasifier at household level? Impractical, okay, like if you go and talk to anyone and look at that gasifier, like nobody would go for it, right? Yeah, so I have operational issues, practical problems, user inconvenience and all. So we thought that our market would be community cooking places. Now, which are these places? Are there enough community cooking places? We did survey, okay, and there are enough community cooking places, ashram schools, dhabas and all that, and they are supported by government anyway, right? They are supported by government, the cooking expenses, all are taken care by government. So this is another model, like trying to make government more or strengthen them in terms of their economics, right? And we came up with a kind of model wherein, like, in a given area, okay, if you have so much biomass being generated, that can be used to make pellets and it can be used in community kitchens.
Sir, you can collect this gas in the container?
No, that's a problem, okay? So, what is this gas? This gas is, those who are from chemistry or chemical engineering background would know, carbon monoxide and hydrogen, okay, and both are quite harmful, okay, especially carbon monoxide is highly toxic, and the gas that comes out, okay, is at atmospheric pressure, and it is highly dilute with nitrogen and all. I'll probably tell you about a process, but then because of that, I can't really compress it much. Okay, it's not like CNG. Okay, it's a dilute gas with low calorific value. So the idea is to generate it and burn it there itself. Okay, and use it for cooking purpose.
But pellet, we will collect.
We'll make pellets. So like now it's a process. You're making pellets and you're distributing that to different ashram schools. Okay. Right, and there it will be burned, it will be used as a fuel. So this is the status of community ashram schools, okay, and it is not in a good condition, really not. If you go and stand there for 2 minutes, you will start suffering. Okay, it's really like particulate emissions and all. Somehow the people who are doing cooking there are used to it, okay, but somebody going from outside cannot even stand there for more than 5 minutes. Okay, I've experienced myself. Okay, because there is so much wood burning happening, and so many particulates, and sometimes incomplete combustion and all, you have problems. Okay. So we thought we'll do a field trial. First, we developed this gasifier. Okay, what's the technological challenge in this? Now, let me talk about the problem. Okay, if it was so easy, people would have come up with a gasifier. Gasifier is not a rocket science. Okay, now the thing is, the gasifiers which are available in market, okay, they run on wood as a feedstock. Now, what is wood? Wood is again a very typical biomass, but doesn't have any not much inorganic content. Okay, not much ash in it. That means you burn wood, you get very small amount of ash, right? But if you burn agro waste, you burn garden waste, okay, you will see a lot of ash. That means the inorganic content is very large. Okay. So the gasifiers which are developed for wood cannot be used for garden waste, even if you make pellets. Okay, right? And by the way, why do we use? I didn't ask this question. Why do we make pellets? Why not just use biomass? What is the use of pellets?
We compress
them, we condense them. Transportation becomes easy. And you see the gasifier, wood biomass cannot be used again in pellets, right? If you have high ash, there is a clinker formation, then those gasifiers don't work. So you have to develop a gasifier for this. And there is some technology development, laboratory research that went into developing a gasifier that will take a high ash feedstock. Otherwise, for cooking, like, it's a problem. So we have developed a gasifier, we patented it, we have done field trials, working very well. So I won't talk much technical part of it. I'm talking about the dissemination. So you have the model that I was talking about, like the farm, you will get agro waste. You have a pelletizer, a central pelletization facility. Pellets will go to different community cooking places. Okay. So and we have worked. We have done surveys and we have come up with the financial model for this, and we have presented it to government. So, so this is a new gasifier which has all these features. That the clinker formation is an old gas, the conventional gasifier is about 0.35 kg per hour, which comes up to 0.02 kg. But this is the important feature of the developed gasifier. Okay, that even if you use high ash feedstock, okay, you are able to operate it smoothly without much clinker. What is clinker formation? Ash will soften, and the large hard blocks will form inside the gasifier, and the biomass will not move, and you will not get gas out. Okay, a steady supply of gas will be happening. We looked at emissions and all. So we did trials in a place called Dharani, which is a remote area, tribal area in district Amravati, Maharashtra state. And this is the situation where this is where we use gasifier. Some results. Wood required. If you use chula and gasifier, the amount required is when efficiency has gone up. Okay. Then the time required, again the gasifier amount is less. Now the foods are free for sufficiently long time. So like overall, the performance is good, the management is happy. Okay. The field trial has worked very well. Emissions, this is the level, permissible limit, and our emissions are down, and these are with the chula.
can really actually do burning and combustion. That's a problem. So we are able to reduce the emissions as well.